Daniel Blumenstein, no Departamento de Ecologia e Biologia Evolutiva, na Universidade da Califórnia, em Los Angeles. É, o professor Daniel vai falar em inglês, então quem está com seus equipamentos de tradução, coloque nos apostos. I'd like to thank you, Daniel, for accepting the invitation for this productive week with us here.
Thanks for having me. I will try not to speak too fast, and hopefully the translators can keep up. They did a really good job before. However, I have a lot of text on these slides, hopefully, so if you can read English, that will help a little. So what I want to do today is talk about sort of an ongoing story, problem, path I've been taking, where I've been trying to integrate behavioral ecology into wildlife management. And I want to start by really saying, why did I sort of begin thinking about this? And and what's my background sort of perspective and philosophy, if you will, on this? And I'll say that it's modeled off our national, the US National Institute of Health's idea of from bench to bedside, so that you can be doing primary research and you can then try to use that primary research in the National Institute of Health is to influence health, but primary research also can influence potentially wildlife management. Now, in the best of all possible worlds, we don't need conservation behavior. We don't need to solve problems of single species, because that's really the realm of conservation behavior. In the best of all possible worlds, we have ecologically inspired management that saves species. But in many cases, we have a population problem. We have too many of one animal, we have too few of another animal, and we want to modify populations. And in that case, that's really the role of behavior. So research that takes fundamental insights from behavioral biology and applies them to conservation problems and wildlife management problems is really what I'm going to be talking about today. And I'd like to suggest that a theme of this really is that we need to have mechanistic studies, studies that understand the levers that control animals and link those levers to population biology processes. And that's going to give us the ability ultimately to predict how animals will respond to the things that we're doing. So this is a shameless plug for a book that Esteban Fernandez-Yersic and I wrote. That talk about conservation behavior. And if you're at all interested in these ideas, this is our primer of conservation behavior, and it has a variety of topics. And much in the spirit of this book, which has lots of ideas, maybe some solutions, maybe not, what I want to do today is I want to go through lots of ideas and begin getting you thinking about how one can go from, here's something really interesting in theoretical behavioral biology, but here's a link from behavioral biology to conservation biology or wildlife management. So I'm going to be saying a lot and a lot of stories here, and the idea is to get you thinking about how one might do that in your own discipline, in your own special area of focus if you're interested in. And I'm going to say that all of this, this whole discipline, this whole field, conservation biology generally, should be based on, I think, evidence-based decision making. Whenever you have a wildlife management problem, you have a very clear objective, you're trying to solve something, and there are many ways of potentially solving that problem, and you want to make sure that you're using the best possible evidence to do so. And a very effective way to implement that is through adaptive management. So adaptive management can be active adaptive management, where you design experiments and track the outcomes and modify what you're doing based on those experiments. And experiments are great, but sometimes it's not possible to do an experiment. So in many cases, managers end up doing passive adaptive management, where they use historical data or data from uncontrolled experiments to come up with best guess management recommendations, and the fate of which might be adjusted based on the evidence. And that's fine. You can do an experiment, it's much better to do an experiment. So when I go through and talk about a variety of topics today, and ideas that I've got and I'm suggesting, view all of these as testable hypotheses that may or may not work in any given situation. But they're hypotheses, and they might be useful. So I'm going to talk about a lot of things. I'm going to talk about flight initiation distance, how close you can get to something before it moves away, and as a metric to quantify human disturbance. I'm going to talk about the evolutionary ecology of fear. Why do animals not tolerate people? I've been fascinated by the fact that you put a hiking trail in a park and you start losing species. How can you predict which species will be lost? Why? I'm going to talk about some ideas about how we might ask how and where animals may fear, feel safe. There's a whole geography of fear that we need to understand better. I scare things. So you know, I'm going to talk about fear a lot. But animals feel safe in certain areas, and you know, how do we understand that? How do we map that? How do we understand the geography of this? And then I'm going to talk about some ideas that are, I think, potentially generalizable ideas, and I think that as a theoretical behavioral ecologist, we want to come up with explanations, generalizations, models of life. So I'm going to talk about anthropogenic noise and something I call the distracted prey hypothesis. I'm going to talk about natural history of habituation and something I call the contiguous habitat hypothesis. And I'm going to talk about the multi-predator hypothesis and the evolutionary persistence of behavior. So buckle up your seatbelts. Let's kick off. So why study anti-predator behavior? You know, what is anti-predator behavior? Things animals do to reduce the probability of being detected by a predator, or attacked by a predator, or killed by a predator, are all aspects of anti-predator behavior. And this includes adaptations to detect predators, identify them, anti-predator vigilance may be important in this, escape from predators, flee them, hide from them, use refugia, and communicate about them. Why would you want to study anti-predator behavior? Well, there are direct effects of predation on populations and communities. Predation, we know, can be a very strong selective force. It's going to influence habitat selection. It can influence population persistence. So for example, I spend most of my time these days studying marmots, large brown squirrels. We'll talk about those tomorrow. And it turns out that local populations go extinct if there is not good visibility. So you can have population, metapopulation extinction based on predators can drive metapopulation extinction. And understanding what those key factors are can help understand the habitat that's required for these sorts of species. There can also be indirect effects of predation risk in populations and community. Fear alone can influence where animals go and what they do. Fear alone can structure communities. And then, you know, predation has often been implicated in wildlife management failures. I was in Brazil November, and I had the great fortune to visit my friend and colleague Carlos Ruiz Miranda, who introduced me to the very successful Golden Lion Tamarin project. The Golden Lion Tamarin reintroduction success story is one of the best conservation behavior success stories. And it's also, and it was because the tamarins were being released, they were all being killed, and they said, well, let's think about what they, and starving, let's think about what behavioral problems there are that can be applied to this. And it's a wonderful success story, and it was really cool to go out and see them. In many cases, animals are being reintroduced or translocated to recover a population. And it's in many cases, this is one of those key areas where behavior can be important and knowledge behavior can be important. Okay, so we know that humans change animals' behavior. And I would suggest that a key to understanding how humans impact animals is to view people as predators. Predators approach animals, animals flee and hide from them. So why do some species tolerate disturbance while others don't? Flight initiation distance is the distance at which an individual flees an approaching person. It's a method to quantify perception of predation risk, and it's a method that can be used to aid wildlife management. I developed a comparative data set that has about 300 species with about 10,000 flushes where assistants and I would walk towards birds and scare them, and use this to ask a variety of questions, and still use this to ask a variety of questions. Now, one of the insights that was important to demonstrate, which is obvious to anyone that goes out and looks at animals, but hadn't been statistically demonstrated until this point, is that flight initiation distance can be a species-specific trait. This is looking at flight initiation distances for some birds outside in Sydney, Botany Bay, outside Sydney, Australia, right under where the airport is. And we looked at different species at different locations around the bay that had different degrees of human disturbance. Some of them were protected areas, some of them were public beaches. And you can see that generally, species that are flighty at one location are flighty at another location. This says that even though flight initiation distance is a very adaptive, plastic trait that varies very dynamically within individuals and within populations, there's still a species, or there may be a species-specific signature. And that opens the door towards asking comparative analyses, or asking comparative questions using formal comparative analyses. So in one series of analyses, we sort of discovered that it turns out large body size birds detect approaching humans at greater distances. Body mass, it turns out, is the best predictor of flight initiation distance in many, many analyses. Here I'm plotting phylogenetically independent contrast values in the comparative perspective. So if you want to know, you know, who's going to be disturbable, big species are disturbable. This was not because larger species had larger eyes. In a data set that I looked at, I did not find an effect of eye size on flight initiation distance. In some other data sets that other people have looked at, they are finding eye size may be part of this. Larger birds flush at greater distances. Did I say larger? Birds detect humans at greater distances, and larger birds also flush at greater distances. After controlling for body mass and starting distance, turns out the distance you start walking towards something influences how soon it will flush as well. Birds that first reproduce at an older age are more flighty. So there are some life history traits that are important in explaining species differences in disturbability to humans in this case. There were no effects of some other life history traits or habitat characteristics. We looked at the clutch size. We didn't find an effect of clutch size. We didn't find an effect of the number of days young were fed. We didn't find an effect of longevity. And we didn't find an effect of habitat openness. But species, other analyses demonstrated that flightiness co-evolved with eating live prey and being a cooperative breeder. Eating live prey, why might that be? Well, if you have eyes that can detect movement, maybe you also detect other things. And sociality involves vigilance for lots of things. If you're a social species, you have to look out for others, and you're nosy about what others are doing, or maybe you're worried about someone coming up and, you know, beating you up or something. So it seems that there may be carryover effects or syndromes of sociality that have consequences for, in this case, anti-predator behavior. In another series of studies, we looked at fences and the effect of fences on flight initiation distance. And we did this by going to an area and looking at the same species. So Southern California has very few remnant wetlands. So there are these wetland areas are very few. Some are protected, some aren't protected, many have been built on. One particular wetland was an area called Bolsa Chica. Bolsa Chica was a big ecotourist area. There was a hiking trail around Bolsa Chica, and many, many people go there to look at birds. The other half of Bolsa Chica wetland, same place, was an active oil well. So oil companies had the area fenced, and very few people went into this area because they were actively pumping oil. It turns out that 60% of the US's oil is left in California, which is a statistic that just became, I just realized, which is insane. I had no idea. In any event, this is an area, the same wetland, same contiguous area, but there's a fence. And then, a couple miles away, there's a naval base that stores all of the weapons for the Pacific Fleet, and no one goes there. So we got permission to go there. We were thrown out after 9/11. So we got permission to go there. And this was an area where very, very few people went. If you look at the number of people we detected while we were looking, you know, very few people in these two areas, and a lot of people in this area. So then you can say, well, how does bird flight initiation distance, how's that correlated with that? What we find is that for these four species of wetland birds, we found no significant differences in how they responded in either the fenced area or an area where no one went, and they responded quite differently in areas where there were a lot of people. They tolerated closer approach. Now, the really important thing is this fence, same birds were moving all around this area, it looked like. The fence afforded safety. Fences are management tools and can be can influence animals' perceptions of risk. Now, typically when you walk towards something, many, many data sets show that a direct approach is more threatening than what's called a tangential approach. A direct approach is I walk straight towards someone. A tangential approach is I'm walking by someone. But in both cases, you're getting closer to a particular person. With colleagues in Argentina, we asked a question in these high alpine grasslands where there was a lot of visibility. Birds could see everything. What we found for four species was that in these open areas, peripheral or tangential approaches were actually more alarming than direct approaches. So each of these graphs plots alert distance, the distance an animal looked initially at a person, and flight initiation distance. So we're looking at relationships here between when that bird detected someone and when they flew away. And what you see is that the tangential lines are the dotted lines, and the direct lines are the solid lines. What that means is, for any given alert distance, there were systematically greater tangential approaches led to systematically greater flush distances, which we didn't expect at all, and suggests a testable hypothesis about visibility and habitat structure. Turns out that some birds are more wary when more people approach them. So, you know, you don't always go out bird watching or looking at animals alone. Often it's a social activity, and you can ask the question, you know, is a group of people more disturbing than not? And for crimson rosellas in Australia, two people are more disturbing than a single person, but geometry doesn't really matter. If you're side by side or back to front, it doesn't really matter, but two people are more disturbing. In terms of looking for generalizations, I kept seeing in these data sets that flight initiation, its starting distance, the distance I started experimentally approaching animals, seemed to be really an important predictor of flight initiation distance. And I sort of initially, tongue-in-cheek, suggested that this is a rule of behavior. Well, it turns out, we just got this published yesterday, animals generally seem to flush early and avoid the rush. And in this phylogenetic meta-analysis of many studies of flight initiation distance, the effect sizes range from 0.7 for mammals to 0.66 for birds, lizards that you approach very slowly, 0.2, or lizards you approach rapidly, 0.59. It's a generalization that as you start walking towards something at a greater distance, it's more disturbed. So if animals can see you at greater distances, if people are, if ecotourists are going out there and looking at animals at greater distances, they can have a greater effect on animals. So, you know, these are a bunch of theoretically inspired questions. Let's just remember what the implications for conservation and management might be. I think this research has stimulated other studies that have used flight initiation distance to study life history, trade-offs, and risk-taking. And I think it's a good technique to do that, and other people have generated some other really interesting insights. I would predict or expect, hypothesize, that larger birds and social birds and those that eat live prey are going to be especially vulnerable to human disturbance. I'm going to say that more people are likely to be more disturbing, that indirect approaches may not necessarily be less disturbing, particularly in areas where animals can monitor people, where there's really good visibility. The Amazon is very different than a beach. And that some results from individual-based models suggest that larger birds, which are more easily disturbed, have lower expected fitness than smaller birds. And that I think there is a need to develop and parameterize with real data these individual-based modeling approaches. We need to parameterize models with real data and apply these to real problems. Now, my great frustration in the US is that, you know, if you study human health issues, you get money from the National Institute of Health. If you ask, you know, evolutionary questions, you might get money from the National Science Foundation, but they don't have any money. If you ask a very applied conservation question, you might get money from a manager. But this sort of research falls between all of those gaps. It's conceptually inspired, theoretically inspired management research, which tries to come up with generalizations that may be useful for lots of situations, and no one wants to fund it. So it's really hard to do this stuff. So we make lots of noise. And we know from a growing literature that this anthropogenic noise may mask biologically important signals, and it may change signal structure. Birds, particularly, may sing over or under anthropogenic noise to avoid things. Noise may create physiological stress. Buses going by, animals that live near highways, closer to roads, have more stress than not. Same thing for people. Population distributions may be affected by noise. And noise can directly harm animals. Think of the incredibly loud sounds that people are using in the oceans, well, the US Navy's using in the oceans, can directly harm animals. But loud noises can directly harm other animals too, their hearing or blow out their swim bladders or whatever. So these are concrete examples of how noise can, anthropogenic noise, can influence animals. Turns out, I think that there's another idea out there too, or something that requires a little more thought. And I'm going to call this the distracted prey hypothesis. So any stimulus that an animal can perceive is capable of distracting it by reallocating part of its finite attention and thus preventing it from responding to an approaching predator. The main point is that attention is finite. You can't pay attention to multiple conversations going on at one time. You have to focus on one individual that you're communicating with. You have to focus on maybe on some biologically important things. And if something distracts your attention from those biologically important things, it might have a biological consequence. So the idea is that attention can be compromised by external anthropogenic stimuli. And it turns out those can be in multiple modalities. So if I'm doing this, or if someone starts taking their clothes off behind me, you're probably not going to be able to pay as much attention to me. So anything that an animal or we can perceive in any modality potentially can distract it. And if it's distracting it from some biologically important task, like trying to detect and avoid predators, it could have a demographic consequence. So birds and mammals and reptiles and invertebrates all use attention to focus on relevant stimuli. This is a, if you're alive, if you're an animal, there's attentional processes. So we've developed hermit crabs, terrestrial Caribbean hermit crabs, as a model system to study distraction. And instead of flight initiation distance, hermit crabs pull back in their shells when they get scared. So we're going to talk about hiding initiation distance. First experiment was a study where this emerged from a student project on a field biology course that I teach. And they said, we want to know if motorboat noise influences hermit crabs. I'm like, okay, why? And they said, we don't know. And I said, well, let's think about attention and distraction and whatever. And they said, oh, that's a good idea. So we designed some experiments we used the playbacks of motorboat noise. And this was an area where at the time there were very few motorboats. This is in the Virgin Islands. And at times there's many motorboats. But at this time it was a low tourist season and there weren't any motorboats. It was a quiet time. So we walked towards these hermit crabs. We had a silent approach. And we added noise, or we added what I call the disco party boat. We added noise and a strobe. So the first thing we found is that crabs can be approached closer when boat motor noise is broadcast. So we do a playback of boat motor noise, and we can approach closer to the crabs before they hide in their shells. And it wasn't just when we're walking towards an animal, we're vibrating the ground or something. So we created this shirt had a clash. It was a clash T-shirt. So basically, we swung a clash T-shirt towards these poor crabs. No vibrations, no movement, and it was this looming object that had the same sort of an effect. When the boat motor noise was broadcast, that looming object could get closer to the crab before it hit. And then we had the disco party boat, and we added a strobe in addition to the noise, and the boat plus the lights allowed us to get closer to the crabs. So then we said, let's bring this into captivity. And here we're looking at latency to high, and we have an LCD monitor, and we have an expanding scary stimulus. This bird worked really well. And it's a similar sort of thing, but we can control everything because now it's in captivity. And I mean, these are findings that predict first principle predictions that the duration and amplitude of stimuli should also influence the magnitude of distraction. And it seems to. So here we're measuring this as the latency to hide from a looming predator, and we find that short sounds versus loud sounds, short sounds, the latency to hide is shorter, meaning short sounds are less distracting than loud sounds. Short sounds are less distracting than long sounds, and loud sounds are more distracting than quiet sounds. So the magnitude of stimulus should influence response, and it does. But this is what you might predict, but it sort of shows that you can begin to really clue in on ways to think about attention. Okay. I like being an ecotourist. I'm sure if you're a biologist, you like being an ecotourist. We go out and we take pictures of things. And what I don't quite understand is why digital SLRs have a sound with them. But they do have a sound with them. So I mean, when I used to take pictures, I had a mirror and it made noise and big clacks and shutters. But digital SLRs can be really quiet. But they still have a shutter, a mirror that goes up, and they still make a sound. So you can ask, do camera sounds scare animals? So we were looking at brown anoles in the Caribbean, and we did a playback experiment where we had silence, and we had a banana quit singing, and we had a kestrel call. So it turns out that many species respond to the sounds of their predators. And that's probably a wise thing. If an animal knows the predator's around because it's communicating with other predators, it knows there's a higher background risk of predation. So many species, either through learning, some evidence for that, or even in some cases through some innate predispositions, are able to respond to the sound of their predators. Here we're looking at changes in display rate. So in this particular experiment, lizards, you know, are sort of sitting on a tree and they're head bobbing or moving their dewlap in this case. And if you look before a playback experiment or after a playback experiment and compare after minus before, you get a change in display rate. So a banana quit is a little Caribbean bird that doesn't eat any lizards, and they're very common. And if banana quits are singing, it looks like the lizards like to display. It's probably a good thing if banana quits are singing. But if you play back the sound of a kestrel, a predatory bird, on lizards, they reduce their display rate. So then we did a playback experiment with the sound of a shutter. And because this initially was designed as a multimodal experiment, we actually thought that sound wasn't going to be important. We thought that the flash would be important because lizards are very visual animals. Turns out it doesn't really matter. Sound or sound plus flash lead to the same response. They suppress their display rate. And they just suppress it in a way very similar and in a magnitude similar to that created by a kestrel. So take only pictures and leave only fear. So, you know, we think we're doing benign things, but actually, you know, we're probably scaring these poor guys. There you have it. So I think there's a full employment scheme for studying the natural history of habituation. I think we know a lot about habituation. I think we've known a lot about habituation for over a century. Habituation in general is a decline in responsiveness to a particular stimulus, repeated exposure. Sensitization, by contrast, as repeated exposure leads to bigger responses. But we know nothing about the natural history of this. We know nothing about the conditions under which animals are more likely or less likely to habituate or sensitize. We don't, in some cases animals sensitize, in some cases they habituate. I'm going to come back to that sort of through two ways of thinking about this. First question is, can ecotourists impair survival? Dik-diks are these little African ungulates, about this big. And they're monogamous, and they're terrified. about 36 species of things eat dick-dicks. So you go out and you drive around and you find this little pair of dick-dicks sitting there quivering. Because that's what they do all day, they quiver. Because there's 36 things on the savannah that want to eat them. So assessing risk to dick-dicks is really important. And as I said, many species respond to the sound of their predators, and we're interested in looking, this is again was a student project in the field biology course, we're interested in understanding how they responded to their predators. So we broadcast jackal calls, jackals equal dicks, and birdsong. And we also wanted to look at the effect of habituation to people on this process. Now, wildlife managers naively often assume that if animals are habituated to people, animals are dumb. And this isn't good for animals. That by habituating animals to people, they therefore no longer respond to real predators. That makes a really important assumption, or there's a testable hypothesis there about how humans are perceived. The idea really is, if you habituate to humans and other predators are perceived similarly to humans, then habituation will transfer to those other classes of predators. That's kind of dumb. May happen, but it's kind of dumb. So the question is that really happening or not? And by looking at habituated dick-dicks versus unhabituated dick-dicks, we could ask that question. What we found is that, so this shows the response to birdsong, jackals, birdsong and jackals, close to people and far from people. On several different predator behaviors. And we're looking at the change in proportion of time before baseline, before playback, and after a playback. And what we found was that unhabituated dick-dicks didn't discriminate between the sounds of predators and benign sounds. It was only the habituated ones made that discrimination. And we're like, that's really interesting. Why is that? Well, I mean, it was really obvious. It was really hard to do playbacks to unhabituated dick-dicks. We would drive around, we would use our car as a blind, we would stop quietly, roll quietly towards a dick-dick, and they'd be quivering, and then we'd wait a while, and then we would do this experiment. These animals were wired. We had ceiling effects to these unhabituated dick-dicks. They were not discriminating between the sound of a predator and the sound of something benign when we were there, because we were alarming them. So I think the take-home message here is that that animals habituated to people are dumb, but that unhabituated animals may be particularly sensitive. So in Colorado, we were asking a similar sort of question with mule deer, and we found, interestingly, a 0.5 kilometer buffer, basically, around permanent habitation that seemed to be similar. I think this question is one that can be applied to many different systems and looking really at the geography, the spatial ecology or the geography of habituation and fear. Human visitation influences risk assessment in Western Gulls. In Los Angeles and Santa Monica, there's a pier. Many, 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 many people go to this pier, and it's along the beach. And if you walk south along the beach, it's a very busy, crazy place. Walking south goes towards Venice, where people hang out on the beach and crazies are. Walking north goes towards Malibu, where the people drop off very quickly, and there are fewer people there. So you can look at the trends of people on one side of this pier versus another side of this pier, and you can ask, is this parallel or reflected in flight initiation distance in these in these Western Gulls, which are very, very common birds in this area? And the answer is yes. That there is a geography, there is a spatial relationship between human visitation and risk assessment in these gulls. But not all species habituate. So this looks at a bunch of different bird species, and they were studied at places where there were lots of people, which are on the left, or few people, which is on the right. And what we find is that in many cases, there's no difference in flight initiation distance in places where there are lots of people or few people. But in these green highlighted areas, there are significant differences, but all in the opposite direction. In all cases, birds in high areas, high visitation areas, flush at greater distances. They weren't seemingly habituating, to people. Rather, they were sensitizing to people. So all of these birds are from Southern California, but they're in chaparral habitat. They're in a habitat which is threatened because of habitat, because of suburbanization and urbanization. People are cutting down chaparral to build houses, but it's pretty contiguous. These wetland, contrast that to the wetland fragments. The wetland fragments are areas where there's been an ecological sorting to some extent. The only birds that live on these wetland fragments have to live on these wetland fragments. They can't live anywhere else. Maybe they already tolerate people, but maybe more importantly, these are birds, these chaparral birds can move around. And I'd say that I'm going to sort of suggest that the contiguous habitat hypothesis is that species living in limited habitats, maybe like wetland fragments, may be more likely to habituate than those living in more contiguous habitats, because they don't have, because they don't have the option to move around. And maybe that's through ecological selection, that some species just don't tolerate people. But nonetheless, I think this is an idea worth testing in other areas. And we can, if it's supported, then it's an idea that might be a generalization to help us with management. So habituation is a key to predicting how species are going to respond to humans and our stimuli. Not all species habituate, and I think the contiguous habitat hypothesis needs to be tested. That more stimuli, both in quantity and quality, may be more disturbing to animals. That lack of habituation to our stimuli may enhance human impacts on wildlife. So, you know, completely unhabituated animals may be really wired by us, and while they're paying attention to us, a predator may come and eat them. Dik-diks and mule deer are distracted by people. Lizards are distracted by cameras. And I think we need to pay more attention to this sort of distraction. And that the spatial scale of habituation may be quite stark. It could be influenced by a fence, or it could occur over several kilometers. So the last thing I want to talk about is some lessons from Australia. Australia is a really fun place to go as a biologist because, and particularly as a conservation biologist, because there's a lot of really innovative conservation biology going on there. I worked for 3 years with a number of species, but I spent a lot of time studying this guy in the middle, the tamar wallaby. Tamar wallabies are the lab rat of marsupials. They're the smallest of the macropod, Macropus genus. They're the big guys, the red kangaroos and the gray kangaroos. These are about the size of a cat. You can keep them in captivity easily, and they're used for a lot of physiological studies. Yet they're eaten by all sorts of things. Historically, they were eaten by large lizards. They were eaten, and still are eaten, by large eagles. Historically, they were eaten by now extinct terrestrial predators, the thylacine. The last 5,000 or so years, they've been eaten by dingoes. But interestingly, it was the introduction of cats and foxes which led to the rapid demise of many species. Australia has the world's worst record of known mammalian extinctions. 16 or 18 species of mammals have gone extinct since European colonization. And most people attribute this to cats and foxes. And it's sort of an interesting question, you know, why, given this long history of exposure to predators, are cats and foxes particularly bad? And part of it may be an ecological problem. With cats and foxes came rabbits, and there were lots of cats and foxes, so there might be hyperpredation explanations as well. In any event, the approach we took in Australia involved traveling around and looking at different populations that had different histories of exposure to predators, and really trying to ask the general question, what happens when you move to suburbia? What happens when you move to a safe place? Do you still lock your door at night? Do you still carry your keys and mace in your hand when you're walking to your car? How long does fear persist, and how might we understand that? Because there are profound consequences of that for wildlife management, particularly with respect to translocations. So one comparison I want to talk about is comparing Kangaroo Island, which is an area, an offshore island, where tamar wallabies have been isolated from mammalian predators for 9,500 years, but they have aerial predators. Contrast that to a place in Western Australia on the mainland, where they have a rich history of exposure to historically important terrestrial predators, more recently cats and foxes, as well as aerial predators and a large, historically large lizards. The Tetonian population almost went extinct, and it was through some aggressive conservation, basically they poisoned all the foxes, that the population came back. We looked at a number of anti-predator behaviors, group size effects, how animals change time allocation as a function in group size. We looked at trade-offs between foraging and vigilance. We looked at where animals were active, and we looked for wallabies, at least, at flight initiation distance. We know, in general, that sociality dilutes predation risk. I certainly teach my students, or maybe they can discover this empirically, that if you're surfing alone, you've got some risk of being killed by a shark. If you surf with a buddy, you can make the convenient assumption that the shark will only eat one of you. You've just halved your risk simply through dilution, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Three or so models of anti-predator behavior, dilution, detection, and some other models, predict a nonlinear response in the probability of being killed by a predator with increasing group size. And if that's true, we often see animals trading off this decreased risk with a parallel reduction in time allocated to anti-predator vigilance. They can forage more with greater groups. So what we found is that, this is sort of a complex graph, what we found is that on Kangaroo Island, Tetonian, looking at wallabies, so Kangaroo Island is the safe place, Tetonian is the dangerous place. We're looking for the evidence of group size effects, both for foraging and looking, and for tamarisk, we found it. What I neglected to say is that on Kangaroo Island, Western great kangaroos have no predators, and they haven't probably for 9,500 years. So Western great kangaroos are perfectly safe on Kangaroo Island, but wallabies still face some risk of predation by terrestrial predators. So we find changes in time allocation for Western great kangaroos at the risky place, but not at the safe place. So anti-predator behavior, in this case group size effects, are malleable and can be lost over time. What about trade-offs between foraging and looking? These are quite plastic. Both species were more vigilant at the risky location. They were more vigilant at the Tetonian site than the Kangaroo Island site. Space uses plastic. So one thing I didn't say is that both of these species spend their days in dense, dense cover. And at night, they come out and they forage in open areas. And the question is, what do? So to use a North American baseball analogy, the tamar wallabies, you know, come out and they go out, and if they get scared, they go back into cover. At the risky site, they forage on average closer to cover than at the safe site. By contrast, kangaroos would come out at Tetonian, and they would come out around sunset, and they'd get up and they'd look around, and they'd skip out to the center of these open areas, and they'd get up and look around. Cover was obstructive for kangaroos. Cover was protective for tamar wallabies. So that's another thing that's quite plastic. We couldn't flush the kangaroos at the scary site, at the high-risk site, because they were very scared all the time. But flight initiation distance was quite plastic for wallabies. So anti-predator behavior varies along a continuum of plasticity. Some of these are quite plastic, some of them are constrained. And the question then becomes one of why the constraints? What drives these constraints? Why might group size effects persist in tamar wallabies? I sort of led to the answer before, they have one predator there. So the hypotheses for constraint are the ghost of predators past hypothesis, there's a pleiotropic hypothesis, and there's a functional integration hypothesis. And all of these acknowledge that if you lose predators, maybe it's no longer adaptive to allocate as much time for any predator vigilance or things like that. And that the ghost of predators past hypothesis says, well, there were predators in the past and you just don't lose it. The pleiotropic hypothesis says that in really a genetic way, genomic way, these are pleiotropic traits, and therefore that you can pull things out of the system and you can still keep them. And the functional integration hypothesis says that, well, you need vigilance for social reasons in addition to any predator reasons, and therefore because you always have to be vigilant socially, these are functionally integrated and you're going to maintain these traits, even if there's no current benefit from doing so. So I sort of pulled these together and predicted that something I call the multi-predator hypothesis, or proposing something called the multi-predator hypothesis, that the presence of a single predator will maintain pleiotropic or otherwise linked or integrated anti-predator behavior. We know to some extent that complex systems don't function well if parts are removed. So we probably expect integrated or pleiotropic anti-predator behavior. For example, if you're in the US and North American grasslands, we have an antelope called the pronghorn antelope. Pronghorn antelope can run 75 miles an hour at a high speed. There's nothing that can run that fast and chase them now. But they evolved with North American cheetah, which have been extinct for many years, but they still run that fast. If you're a small ungulate, when you're a baby, you have spots, and when you have those spots, you also have to be immobile. Your mother leaves you in a place and comes back and nurses you, and then you stay immobile and have your spots. If you have spots but jump around, that's not going to be so good. As an adult, you rely more on speed to escape predators. So any way you look at it, we expect all of these things to co-evolve. We expect all of these things not to be assorting independently. So that's true. Maybe anti-predator behavior will generally be linked in some way. I mean, these are genomic tests that we now have the technology to begin to address. And that selection should maintain these linkages if there's any benefit from doing so. In other words, as long as there are some predators. So the multi-predator hypothesis then says that animals living with some predators will maintain anti-predator behavior, while those living without any predators will lose it. So we studied tamar wallabies at a couple other locations. One was a location where there were snakes, but there weren't mammals and there weren't raptors, and the snakes would eat the wallabies. And the other location was New Zealand, where 130 years before we were studying them, the New Zealand governor at the time, Governor Gray, decided he wanted some mammals in his property and brought over tamar wallabies and some other species from Australia. The New Zealanders want to get rid of them all now because they're an invasive pest. So we can go around and say, well, do we see group size effects in locations where, any location where there are any predators? And do we not see group size effects where there are no predators? And the answer is yes. In New Zealand, lower right hand, we don't see group size effects. In any of these other locations, Garden Island where there's snakes, Tutunning where there's everything, and Kangaroo Island where there are only raptors, we see group size effects. Preliminary support for the multi-predator hypothesis. What else? Well, these predator recognition, I'm not showing the data on this, but predator recognition abilities degrade quickly following the loss of all predators. New Zealand animals don't have good discrimination abilities. 130 years, they lose their ability to discriminate predators, they lose group size effects. Whereas Kangaroo Island animals have the ability to discriminate predators, even novel predators, which they haven't seen before, which is really interesting. Western gray kangaroos, we saw, lost their group size effects on Kangaroo Island where they had no predators. So maybe it took longer, maybe, I don't know how fast it was lost, but they don't have group size effects there. So, and then there's other support for this from other taxa as well. But it's a testable hypothesis, and it has implications for management in the sense that if you have a choice of getting an animal that you want to bring back into or translocate or reintroduce to a location, try to find animals from places that have some predators, if possible. So what do we want to conclude? Well, I think we need to develop mechanistic models to predict how animals respond to humans. I think we can use flight initiation distance as a metric to gain insight into how animals perceive risk. I think that anthropogenic stimuli may distract animals and enhance vulnerability to predators. I think that not all animals habituate to disturbance. We need to know the conditions of habituation versus sensitization. I can have a testable hypothesis about that. I think that the presence of any predators may maintain any predator behavior, even for extinct predators, if those extinct predators resemble new predators, which is a sign of hope in many cases. And I think that all of these ideas can be applied to solve conservation problems but they have to be tested in an adaptive management framework. And I want to go on a little bit, because I think from some discussions we've been having in our meeting earlier, I think it's important to think about I'm going to call a headbanging process, trying to take this knowledge and really develop meaningful collaborations with managers. So I wrote a number of years ago sort of 13 things a behavioral biologist can do to help with conservation. But I think this applies, some of these apply more generally to working with managers in a number of fields. And one of them is, you know, studying endangered species. I try to have my students not study endangered species because often you have sample size problems, but managers are worried about endangered species. So if you want to help a management problem, study an endangered species. Work in an endangered habitat or a threatened habitat. There's a paper that just came out, Science, Nature, something, this week I think, that showed that places where people were studying lots of things or studying anything actually led to more realization by local people about the value of this habitat and also more inadvertent protection of those habitats. So working in an endangered habitat not only builds knowledge, but it also may build community linkages, and it also may protect those habitats. Work on a question of conservation concern. There are many questions of conservation concern. Study more than one species at a time. I mean, we know very little about most species on Earth. So if it's possible to study more than one species at a time, collect data on more than one species. Capitalize on unnatural experiments. You know, someone brings a dog to a field station, the dog kills all of your animals. Oh my God, that's horrible. Yeah, it is horrible. But maybe it's something that you can learn from, or you can learn from other unintended disasters that happen, you know, around you while you're studying things. Apply Tinbergen's four questions. So for the behavioral biologists here, you know, four ways of asking questions, two about proximate questions, two about ultimate. By applying Tinbergen's four questions, you really get a very comprehensive, integrative understanding of behavior, and you gain more insights into mechanisms. And I think you'll notice that many of those questions I was looking at slot into Tinbergen's core questions. Develop and test predictive models of animal behavior. If we are to make predictions, which managers need, we need to be able to understand those levers of control. Predictive models are the tools that we need to develop. Talk with a wildlife manager. Better yet, listen to a wildlife manager. What are your problems? What do you need to do? Oh, that's interesting. I can't help with that, but did you know my friend over here might be the person? Or that's a really good question. Maybe we can design an experiment out of this. In the US at least, it's very common for conservation plans to be publicly posted and to comment, to allow the public to comment on them. A lot of conservation in the US is very stakeholder driven, for better or for worse. So that means that anyone who says, I want to be a stakeholder, is a stakeholder. So if there are ways of commenting on conservation plans, that's a way to learn about what the issues are and be heard. Teach conservation behavior. Teach how these ideas can potentially be applied. I have a textbook for that. Go to lunch with a population biologist, because it's population biology that is what conservation biologists care about. You either want to get a population up, or you have a management problem and you want to get it down. And, you know, understand more population biology and think how behavior has demographic consequences one way or the other. Go public. Share your ideas with others. And finally, and this is the hard one, because, you know, it always happens, just don't give up. I think we have to keep banging our heads against the wall here. I can talk about a number of projects where I was specifically asked to get involved as a conservation behaviorist by wildlife managers, and ultimately, after lots of really productive planning, the projects were shut down at the last minute because suddenly there was some concern, or suddenly this was too invasive, or suddenly this was whatever. And that's really frustrating. But don't give up, because I think that, you know, we have ecologists, behavioral biologists, evolutionary biologists have tools that are important for conservation, and we just have to keep trying to, you know, save more and more species. Thank you very much. Thank you so much for having me here. It's been a real educational experience, and I've really enjoyed talking with a lot of people here, and I hope the conversations will continue.
Temos 7 minutos para questões. Hilton.
Hi, Daniel. You're very much for your talk. Wonderful ideas. Many hypotheses to test. I'd like to hear you a bit more about the if you could talk about the link, the way you see the link between populate studies in behavior in one species or one small group of species and community effects for the preservation of the ecosystem as a whole. Do you see there is a link? Because I have seen some papers which say, well, we have been studying, trying to conserve many environments in many different ways, and the conclusion was, well, the places where we have had most success is when we know natural history. That's when we know small and easy things about the species. I would like to hear you on that.
So Tim Carrow, who's one of the founders of the discipline of conservation behavior, after editing his big edited volume, the last chapter is why behavior isn't useful for conservation, basically. And then he's sort of gone on and been a very critic of conservation behavior, which is interesting. But, I mean, I think I'm going to come back to where I started, which is conservation behavior is really a single species management tool. And conservation biology is, if conservation biology is working, we don't have conservation behavior problems. It's only when you have a problem with a single species, whether something's too abundant, quote, too abundant, or something's not abundant enough, that I think that it becomes very important to begin thinking about behavior and conservation. Now, having said that, if ecotourists, if we're loving our animals to death, developing a better understanding of the varied mechanisms by which we may be disturbing whole communities of animals and using comparative analyses to make generalizations about vulnerable types of species could be useful as well to reduce our sort of behavioral footprint on things. So I think that that in any given case, so I don't think there are a lot, I mean, I made some generalizations, but I think those are useful if you're doing something, if you're putting in a hiking trail, if you're trying to, if you have a declining population of birds in a small habitat and you say, well, what can I do to reduce the impact of people on this, but people want to see it? Or, you know, what are guidelines for ecotourism? I think you can come up with some testable hypotheses about guidelines for ecotourism from these sorts of things. But conservation behavior is sort of a last-ditch thing. So is single species management. I mean, we do single species management in the US because the Endangered Species Act we have says you have to. But you've already lost the battle if you've got to save a species from the brink of extinction. If you can save the habitat and save those communities, then you don't have to do any of this stuff.
Mais questões? Acho que tem tempo. Yeah, we have time.
I'd like to thank you also for your talk. It was very interesting. I never heard too much about the subject. You sometimes cited that some of this knowledge can be used for reintroduction or translocation of animals. Do you have any examples of things that were done to translocate or reintroduce and that use the knowledge that was produced in a fashion like this, and it helped the reintroduction?
So the Golden Lion Hammering Project is the best case, one of the best cases of specifically using behavioral knowledge to increase reintroduction success. Animals were being reared in zoos, and then they had to be basically trained to recognize predators, to learn how to eat and what to eat. And once these behaviorally invasive processes were instituted, the population went up from a few hundred to a few thousand. And now it's pretty much a self-sustaining population that continues to grow. There, these days they're much more interested in connecting corridors of these Atlantic coastal fragments to make sure it's a self-sustaining population. But I mean, it's a tremendous success. The original translocated animals are mostly dead, and the descendants of those are doing fine. So that's a great example. There are other examples. So if you translocate prairie dogs, prairie dogs are a species of ground squirrel in North America, and there are places where people are quite interested in translocating prairie dogs, because prairie dogs are the preferred food for black-footed ferrets, which are an endangered species of ferret. It was one of the species that was thought to be extinct and was rediscovered. So people are moving prairie dogs around, and if you just, they're social, if you catch them and just throw them out, they don't do that well. If you move them in a family group, they do really well. You also have to teach, if you're breeding prairie dogs, you also might have to pre-expose them to predators and get them thinking about predators so they don't all get eaten by something else, so there's enough prairie dogs for ferrets to eat. So I think that those are a couple of concrete examples. The whole Tamar Wallaby project was designed to lead to an adaptive management intervention. And it's one of those processes where for years, we got tons of money from the Australian government to do this, because these animals were going to be repatriated from New Zealand and brought back to a mainland South Australian population. And everyone was on board until suddenly our whole project was shut down. Oh, well, you know, maybe we shouldn't be doing this because it'll scare them. Maybe we shouldn't be doing this because, and you know, this is after years of negotiation. We had to give money back to granting agencies because the managers got cold feet about parts of the project at the last minute, which was very frustrating.
Nosso tempo de discussão tempo. Então nós voltamos às 4:28.